everyone, you are welcome to online economic class. Today we have to discuss 7th chapter Indian economy. Till last class we completed the first chapter introduction to microeconomics. In this chapter we have to discuss about understand the current status of Indian economy in terms of features, natural resources, infrastructure facilities and so on, and to understand the contribution of major Indian economic thinkers. Right, let us see the introduction of Indian economy. Meaning of growth and development. Whenever we are going to discuss about the economy of a country, we should know about the what is growth and what is development. So that now we are going to discuss about the Indian economy, right? That's why we should know about the meaning of growth and development of Indian economy. A country's economic growth is usually measured by national income, indicated by gross domestic product, which means GDP. Okay, GDP only determining the national income. Through the GDP, we can analyze and understand about the economic situation of the country. The GDP is the total monetary value of goods and services produced by the country over a specific period of time, usually 1 year. We know that, which is GDP, isn't it? Overall production, goods and services produced by the country over a period of time, which may be 1 year. The level of economic development is indicated not just by GDP, but by an increase in citizens. So citizens' quality of life or well-being. This also indicating the GDP, whether GDP is increasing or decreasing. So that the level of economic development indicating by GDP as well as the citizens' quality of life of the country and their well-being of the country. The quality of life is being assessed by several indicators. Okay, indication means indices such as Human Development Index, HDI, physical quality of life, which is PQLI, physical quality of life index, that is called PQLI, and gross national happiness index, GNHI, gross national happiness index. See here, they given note about GNHI, gross national happiness index. The term gross national happiness was coined by the fourth king of Bhutan, Jigme Singye Wangchuck, in 1972. So Bhutan fourth king name was Jigme Singye Wangchuck. It is an indicator of progress which measures sustainable development, environmental conservation, which promotes of culture and good governance. With the help of the good governance, who can give good governance? The government. Okay, so the government only having that much of a responsibility about the people. So that it is an indicator of progress which measures sustainable development. So whether the country keeping the sustainable development and environmental conservation, then only it promotes the culture and good governance. Okay, this is called gross national happiness index. So in this situation is going on in a country means the people automatically happy, okay, happy to survive in the country. So the country, whether they living with the happy or not, which is indicating about the development of the country. On the basis of the level of economic development, nations are classified developed and developing or underdeveloping countries. Understood? Depends upon the economic development, whether the country is developing, developed or underdeveloped country. So utilize the country, utilize the resources. Okay, the country should utilize the resources for their industrialized and utilize the resources efficiently and have high per capita income. Increasing the per capita income, and then they can classify whether they are coming under developing or developed or under developing. The USA, Canada, UK, France and Japan are some of the developed countries. So that these countries keeping per capita income in high rate. Developed economies are also termed as advanced countries. Okay, developed economies experiencing in the developed countries. Just now I said, you know, USA, Canada, UK, France, Japan. On the other hand, countries which have not fully utilized their resources like land, mines, workers, etc. and have low per capita income and termed as underdeveloped countries, underdeveloped economies. So that the resources are properly utilized countries getting development. Simultaneously, those who are not utilizing their resources properly, that countries and all going downward, which is leads to underdeveloping their economy. For example, underdeveloped countries are sub-Sahara, Africa, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Pakistan, Indonesia, etc. These are the examples of underdeveloped countries. What about India? India is developing country. Understood? They are also termed as underdeveloped countries or backward nation or third world nation. These are the name called the countries. Indian economy. Now we have to going through the concept Indian economy. Indian economy is the seventh largest economy of the world. What is that? Seventh largest economy of the world. Being one of the top listed countries. So among the top listed countries, Indian economy got seventh largest economy of the world. In terms of industrialization and economic growth, India holds a robust position with an average growth rate of 7%, which is given approximately. Understood? So they are increasing their industrialization for their economic growth. Even though rate of growth has been sustainable and comparatively stable, there are still signs of backwardness in India. So though we are getting all the initiation to improving our development and industrialization, still now the signs of backwardness going on. We can see. We know that depends upon the per capita income, growth and development, the country classified into developed, developing and underdeveloped. So what are the features of developed economy? If a developed economy exists in a country, means that country has some features. What are they? Suppose they have high national income. The developed countries are economically wealthy. That's why the high national income is there, high per capita income in a country and high standard of living experiencing by the people, full employment of resources, utilizing their utilities and resources. Dominance of industrial sector, high level of technology used by the country, high industrialization also going on there, high consumption level is experiencing there, high level of urbanization going on, smooth economic growth is there, social equity, gender equality and low level of poverty prevailing there, political stability and good governance done by the government. Okay, these are the special features of a developed economy. Understood? The diametrically opposite features of Indian economy are discussed below in detail. So now we have to discuss about the opposite features of Indian economy. The first one is features of Indian economy, which is strength of Indian economy. First we have to discuss about strength of Indian economy and then weakness of Indian economy. So India has a mixed economy. This is the first strength. In the first lesson I taught, isn't it, India experiencing the mixed economy. So that Indian economy is a typical example of mixed economy. This means both private and public sector coexist and functioning smoothly. So here The government and the private sector coexisted and functioning the government, the functioning the development in a country smoothly. On one side, some of the fundamental and heavy industrial units are being operated under public sector, while due to the liberalization of the economy, the private sector gained importance. This makes it a perfect model for public-private partnership. That's why the public as well as the government partnership smoothly going on. Next one is agricultural role, which is agriculture plays the key role in the economy. Agriculture being the maximum pursued occupation in India. So most of the people occupied in agriculture. It plays an important role in its economy as well. Around 60% of the people in India depending upon the agriculture for their livelihood. We know that. Yes, in fact, about 17% of GDP today is contributed by the agricultural sector. So that green revolution, evergreen revolution and invention in biotechnology have made agriculture self-sufficient and also surplus production. So after the independence, our government made some plans, made some program. What are they? Green revolution started by them, evergreen revolution and inventions in biotechnology. These are all have made agriculture self-sufficient. So enough of food production given by them. That's why the surplus also taken by the government in the agricultural production. The export of agricultural products such as fruits, vegetables, spices, vegetable oils, tobacco, animal skin, etc. from the agricultural sector. Also add forex earning through international trading. So that agriculture plays a vital role in the strengthening of Indian economy. Understood? The next one is an emerging market. India has emerged as vibrant economy, sustaining stable GDP growth rate even the midst of global downtrend. So even though the global downtrend going on, the GDP is sustainable because of the vibrant economy. So vibrant economy means we are experiencing the mixed economy, private and public sector coexisting and work together. That's why the vibrant economy sustaining, then they making the stable growth of GDP. So that this has attracted significant foreign capital through FDI and FFI. India has a high potential for prospective growth. This also makes it an emerging market for the world. So throughout the world, India getting market. They earning money from all over world. So that Indian market increasing in all over the world. This is called an emerging market. So that FDI and FFI increasing, which means foreign direct investment. Okay. The emerging economy as a top economic giant among the world economy. India bags the 7th position in terms of national gross domestic product and 3rd in terms of purchasing power parity, PPP. Okay, GDP and PPP, they got this position. Okay, 7th position in the national gross domestic product as well as the 3rd position in purchasing power parity. As a result of rapid economic growth, Indian economy has a place among the G20 country. That's why among the G20 countries, India also got a position. See here, G20 countries given here. So, what are the countries? Argentina, Australia, Brazil, Canada, China, European Union, France, Germany, India, Indonesia, Italy, Japan, Mexico, Russia, Saudi Arabia, South Africa, South Korea, Turkey, United Kingdom, United States. These are the G20 countries. See here, because of the emerging market and emerging economy, we got this position. Understood? Fast growing economy. Indian economy is also fast growing economy. Here the timeline chart given about the fast growing economy. The service sector means doctors, lawyers, teachers, like that. So they are called service sector. They contribute their lion's share of GDP in India. So that what they saying here, the service sector peoples are increasing and their GDP, their contribution of GDP increasing in India. There has been a high rise growth in technical sector like information technology, IT, BPO, etc. They also giving rapid increase in development. These sectors have contributed to the growth of the economy. These emerging service sectors have helped a country go global and helped in spreading its branches around the world. So that they are going for job purpose around the world. Okay, wherever we go, we can identify the Indian peoples. So for their service, they are moving from India to another country. That is, the service sector have helped the country go global and helped in spreading its branches around the world. This is fast growing service sector. And large domestic consumption. The large domestic consumption, with the faster growing rate of the economy, the standard of living has improved a lot. So that a doctor, lawyer, teacher and scientist, like that, service sector people increasing means what will be there? Their standard of living also will be improved. So this turn has resulted in rapid increase in domestic consumption in the country. So domestic consumption will be increased. The standard of living has considerably improved and lifestyle has changed. So they have to change their lifestyle and also improving their standard of living. Rapid growth of urban areas. Urbanization is a key ingredient of the growth of any economy. Okay, if the economy is increasing their urbanization means the country is increasing their GDP. Understood? There has been a rapid growth of urban area in India after independence. The forests are removed by little and increased as a agricultural land and living places. So it is the people also moving rural to urban. So that after independence, urban areas are increased. The improved connectivity in transport and communication, education and health have speeded up the pace of urbanization. Because of urbanization, the population also increasing according to their basic needs and what they want. Whatever they want, they have to increasing themselves. So depending upon the urbanization, changing their lifestyle, changing their lifespan, so that rapid growth of urbanization increasing in India. And then stable macroeconomy. So in India, they maintaining stable macroeconomy. Macroeconomy means as a whole, isn't it? So that the Indian economy has been projected and considered as one of the most stable economies of the world. So all the world accepted as India experiencing the economy, the most stable economy among the world. The current year's economic survey represents the Indian economy to be a haven of macroeconomic stability, resilience and optimism. Okay, they're reducing their optimism and increasing their macro economy. According to the economic survey for the year 2014 to 15, 8% plus GDP growth rate has been predicted, with actual growth turning out to be a little less. Maybe their assumption little less, but they achieved 7.6%. Okay, This is a clear indication of a stable macroeconomic growth, so that which is not decreasing drastically, little bit only less, isn't it? That's why it's clearly saying us the stable macroeconomic, sustainable economic growth going in India. Then next one is demographic dividend. Demographic dividend means the human capital of India is young. This means India is a pride owner of the maximum percentage of youth. So the census saying Indian youths are more than other countries. Okay, so that the young population is not only motivated but skilled and trained enough to maximizing the growth of a country. So that if a country having youth peoples, they can maximizing their growth, which is the choice. Thus human capital plays a key role toward increasing or maximizing the growth prospects. Also this has invited foreign investment to country and outsourcing opportunities too. This also increasing the foreign investment. So invite the foreign investment in India. Okay, student, today we discussed about Indian economy, what is the meaning of growth and development, and features of Indian economy. In features of Indian economy, strength of the Indian economy completed. Okay, then go through the video carefully and answer the questions. What do you have to write today? Features of Indian economy fully you have to write, and also meaning and growth of the development. Okay.